So that's pretty brave of someone to just like go to a new city and just set themselves up and start living. Like, how did that work for you?
Well, like a lot of other jumps, it was scary. But, you know, I think after a while, when you go through like inner and outer obstacles over and over, you just gain a bit more courage to know you're not going to fall. And if you make a decision that you want to change, you can change stuff like that. So I drove there with whatever was in my car that year. I'm from Chicago, and everything was in Chicago, and I came back to New York to teach again. And I knew that I needed to stop one cycle that was helping others and really needed to start building a life that I loved, that felt really supportive and grounded for me. Mm-hmm. So I moved there to build a stronger foundation for myself so I could be of greater service to people in the world.
So what is it that you do, Crystal?
Well, they change lives. You know, for me, that's always been a hard thing to define, but when people ask, you know, I'm here as a guide, and I really assist in wherever a person is growing into, and wherever their soul is, like, wanting to evolve next, or trying to evolve. So sometimes people come to me when their spark is a little dim, you know, and they feel weighed down by the world, or weighed down by their own, call them demons, so to speak, you know. And then we can ignite that passion and that fire back in so they can jump forward in a whole new way. And then sometimes people come to me, a lot of people come to me when they have obstacles going on, you know, and so we kind of join forces together and move through, because I don't believe that we're here to do this all alone at all. And then, but really I feel like the greatest definition of what I do is I love people, and my heart wants us to be able to enjoy being alive. So I do my best to stand as a light and serve as a guide for others on this human journey, you know, on this path. But yeah, that's so many ways to define it, you know. My background is in holistic healthcare, but I love it. I feel like there's the deep work, the navigating through life, and all the stuff we're not taught how to do. That's what I really excel at. So.
And you call yourself a life navigation specialist? Is that right?
That would be one title. Uh-huh. I've been going more by, you know, just saying I'm here as a guide lately, because before it was life navigation specialist, which is true, passion igniter, which is true, and almost like a master. I'm not a master of anything. I don't really believe. I really like to be student first, but more of an empowerment coach, because that's one of the tools in my belt. You know, is coaching and a lot of intuitive guidance work and things like that. So it's a blend of structure and flow. And
so when did that begin for you? When did this start for you, like this path that you're on?
Wow. Ask me in another way.
Okay. Like, I've heard you say before that you've had times of like darkness, depression, body issues. It sounds very painful. Is that what drives you now, those sorts of things?
It used to drive me a lot more. What I realized is that growing up, I was very sensitive. I always thought it was just me, you know? And so I'd be, quote, too emotional, I was told. You know, I'd feel a lot. You know, I could almost feel and my empathy was very strong for the world and for my family and for my friends and everything like that. So for me, a lot of where this work came from is having mountains of heaviness on top of myself and not having any form of guidance on how to dig it out. You know, this is what I bring to the table now, is just homegrown, like, it's almost like when a seed, like that seed that grows through the cement, that's how I feel. And so when people feel like that weightedness, whether it's extreme lack of self-love or feeling so much but not knowing how to apply it and bring it into the world, or just not necessarily knowing how the pieces fit together, all of those were very, very large struggles for me. And learning how to love. You know, I loved the best way I knew how, but I learned a lot of that was, it was very dysfunctional. So kind of unlayering what love is not and letting that true form really grow and mature. You know, it still always is growing and maturing, but all of those big points, that's why when people say, what do you do? It's hard. It is hard for me to say it. It's like, I help others evolve, and here is a mountain of life experiences and then a lot of tools that I went to school for and got different degrees. And so it's a culmination, and everyone's an individual, so I treat everyone like that. I mean,
what was the first class you taught that was like your class that you made up?
What was that? I don't remember the title of the first class I taught. It was a while ago. But I do remember that one of the first classes I taught, it took a lot for me to start using my voice. I felt so much inside, but I was terrified of using this instrument. And one of the first classes I taught was at the Omega Institute. And no one came. It was a staff class. And, you know, I had been prepared, and I'm like, okay, and no one came. And that was that moment, you know, that moment of like, should I be totally devastated right now, or what do I do with it, you know? And I chose to pretend that the room was full of people. And that, like, you know, seen and unseen and all this, and I taught anyway. And I just let that come out, and I spoke to this full room, and I felt that day when I left that something great had happened. Something great had happened. So, it's when you know, it's kind of when you know that your ego steps out of the way, you know, and it wasn't about me at that moment. It was about that I knew that there was an audience out there, that however small I had felt or believed I was, that it almost makes me want to cry, that wasn't true. And that inside I knew that wasn't true, even though I still felt like in prison, you know. So I pushed that out of the side, and I let my heart speak, and I haven't stopped letting my heart speak ever since. And it's had to unravel all the pain and the hurt to go, you know, and now it's like, it's what I teach the most, is how to let that essence, how to feed that, like, spiritual heart, you know, how to really let your authenticity be free, you know, so. That's what I got.
That's amazing. That's seriously amazing story. Oh my god. Nobody came to the first class, but you taught anyway.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I actually brought tears in my eyes for it. What do you dream of? For the world.
My whole life, one thing I always understood was the interconnectedness of everything. I used to draw these like spider webs on my paper as a little girl. You know, you might draw rainbows or clouds or all this, but I always drew spider webs. And then years later, I kept drawing them. And when I went to define what that is, as it's a tattoo I have on my back now, it was symbolizing the interconnectedness of everything, denying this illusion of separateness that we choose to embrace a lot. So for me, that interconnectedness is everything. It's understanding the interconnectedness of the body. It's understanding the interconnectedness of all of us in earth and nature. You know, it's understanding the interconnectedness in relationships and how all of that works. It's understanding that while there are times when we feel like we're just disconnected and separate, we're not. And for me, my greatest dream is to almost, I think because I felt so separate, I was completely disconnected from my body. I didn't associate it as one thing. There was pain here, or hurt here, or like weight here, you know. I didn't understand the interconnectedness with people all the time and why there was all this chaos and drama, you know. And learning to look at that through a different lens really helped me. Learning to look at my body through this lens and connect it so I wasn't separate from myself, so I stopped fighting myself, you know. Learning to understand that nature is one of our greatest teachers, and that we're all, the more we're in communication and learn how to listen to cycles and rhythms, we're not always given the tools to understand that there's so much happening all the time. We just feel weird one day, or, you know, it's like, so coming back, you know, my greatest dream is really standing in a world with people that know that we're co-creators, that don't feel victim to their lives and to themselves and to the world, but they understand that power, you know, and how there is really no divide, you know, that they are made up of ocean water and stardust, you know, be it science or spirituality, it's like the information is there, you know, and when we move from that knowing, it's like suddenly the pieces of ourselves that can only see ourselves as small step aside. And then we're like, whoa, I'm kind of vulnerable out here, you know? So I my greatest dream is really seeing this world unite in interconnection. And especially right now, for us to step up as the creators that we are and to move forth on what wants to birth out of our hearts, the things that we've kind of kept inside, you know? And to shine. My greatest dream is to help others radiate their light, you know, for as much as it sounds, you know, it doesn't feel good to be held down by everything. And as someone who has been for most of her life, I really feel like we are here to move as love. And when we move as love in our own unique form and join together and not try to do it separately, the world does change. And nothing breaks my heart more than to see someone who is so brilliant and so talented feeling so small and stuck in their body and in the world. And so it all weaves together for me. That's why when I say, what do? You stand as a guide. Well, because that person that is so brilliant and so talented but feels so stuck in the world and in themselves that maybe some of them even choose to commit suicide. I said, no, like wait, let's see beyond this veil. And like, let's look at life through a different lens. That maybe I offer a different lens. Maybe I just stand as love the best I can. And that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well. I always used to like really envy people who were free, you know? I remember, you know, I didn't grow up around a lot of this. I grew up a small town, Midwest, you work hard, you know. I didn't have that many dreams, but I had a feeling inside that I was meant to do something more, you know. But I envied people who were free, people who could use their voice and just, you know, sing, or people who were really comfortable in their bodies, you know, and I would do neither. I didn't know what I was passionate about, and I was not comfortable in my body. And, like, freedom is such a huge thing, you know, when you're not free and you learn different ways and tools that you could be free, it's just, it changes everything, you know? So now, yeah. That's it. That's it.
Let's see here. You're doing great, Crystal. Just by the way. yeah. I'm just gonna slightly move the camera. Just very slightly. Just so it's not... There, your head is more centered now. But it's all good. So... Just... Yeah. It's alright. Paul and Eddie and Rumble handle all this. He loves it. So, yesterday during the class, you talked about a lot of things. One thing that I really felt in the moment that it was happening was mentioning and calling in guides.
Mm-hmm.
And what is that for you, and what is your connection, if you'd be willing to talk about that at all? You know, you talking about spiritual guides?
Sure, sure. What is it for me?
Yeah, I mean, what is that connection? What does that feel like for you? And when did that begin? Anything you want to talk
about? I hate to keep going back to struggle, but that's how I feel like where my beginnings came from, you know? At least in on this path. And so, I really did feel quite alone. You know, when I came to a place like the Omega Institute for the first time, which was, I don't know, 11 years ago, I didn't understand the concepts of stuff. I always have believed, I've always wanted to keep that childlike wonder, you know, but for me it disappeared when I was young, so I brought it back later. And whether we're speaking about guides or anything else, I believe that we're foolish to think that there's not more going on than we can see. You know, there most definitely is. And when you start to open that up, things move. So where guides came in for me was this. I was a girl who always like, well, maybe ghosts do exist, you know? And I kind of, ooh, you know, I'd get chills walking into a place. And I couldn't define it. I just was like, you know? And then I did some intuitive development, you know, training, you know? And I saw this woman say, oh, well, I'm working with angels, you know? I just was listening to that all. But it was when I started doing this intuitive development training, I realized that I was tapping into way more information than I knew I had inside. And, you know, we were working with partners, so it was like, all, you know, it was verified. It was like, okay, yes, that's very true. And it came out, I was so surprised. So, okay, there's more going on here. And I'm the type of person in the beginning, like, I want to see it to believe it. I'm not just going to believe something because you tell me it's true, you know. So it started that way. And then, like... I mean, well, let me back to your question. Got a little sidetracked here. It's like, for guides for me, one of the tools that I, in me wanting to understand and learn more about the body, was that I went through massage therapy training and specializing in the scar tissue release, like a myofascial release system. And I saw things coming out of people and in my own path of healing that I couldn't believe were there. And it was, you know, old traumas, and I was like, this is actually stays stuck in the body, you know? So I really dove into wanting to learn about the body, and it fascinated me, and wanting to not hate my own, you know? So I said, okay, I want to keep learning, and it's like unraveling or peeling layers of an onion that never seemed to stop. And so I had an office when I lived in Arizona, and it was a blend of life coaching and massage therapy. And in both of those professions, so to speak, I tried to follow by the rules, if there were any, and I would give a great massage, and it was okay. I mean, it was just like, yeah, it was good, and they were like, oh, my muscles are relieved. But I'd get to the end, and I'd hold their feet, and I'd have more information coming in. And I said, what is this? And at first I didn't share. I didn't feel like it was my right. And then I understood more so that it was like my responsibility. That if there was information there, because every time I did share, it was the person's, you know, it was, there's more, it was, they gave me more praise on that than an hour of a massage where I was working hard, you know. I was like, I didn't get it. And then coaching is very much, whereas therapy is, you know, where let's talk about where you are and where you've been. Life coaching, it's taken off as a profession over the years as far as a title, because it's where are you now and where do you want to go? And we create a plan to get you there. Great. Loved it. Tried to follow by those rules and it didn't work. For me, I would like, I'd start structuring them out. Okay, let's create a plan and I'd have more information. And some people are like, okay, I'm channeling, you know, Archangel Michael energy, or okay, I'm channeling like my great grandfather in his wise old spirit, or, you know, Technahan, or, you know, like these energies of just like these people. For me, it never had a definition. And I remember going, who are you? What are you doing? You know, and there, it just felt like there was information coming in that was useful for people. So now during my classes, you'll hear me. I don't call in specifics. I say, calling on your team of unseen allies, those that are there to help for your greatest and highest good. And when we get out of thinking we're alone and go back to that interconnectedness that we have a whole world of people, and we take off the lenses of alone, the world opens up. And when you call on things that are unseen, some people say, why? I say, why not? You know, I believe that there is so much out there waiting to help us. And sometimes we may have to unbury and learn these lessons, but those are the times we don't think they're there. We're like, why? You know, those are the times people give up on God, so to speak. You know, and it's like, I need you. I don't feel you. I remember screaming to God, like, help me, you know. But after a mountain of trauma and turbulence and, you know, in my life, I'm still here and calling on all of that because it's there. It's very real. And why not call on it? That's my answer. Guides, yes. Are they there? Absolutely. Do I understand it all? No. Would I even try? No. They say that we can see what, like 4% in all actuality of what's going on. So us as humans are like, okay, I got control. I feel better. Okay, this is in place, and now I can breathe. And it's like, sometimes I just laugh. There's so much going on. When you look at the stars, do you think you have them figured out? You know, we're students first. So as a student, I know that there's more helping us than we know. And I open all of that up because this world is filled with a lot of heaviness. And the more we belly on and can build our team together with each other, seen and unseen, of just shedding the heavy and opening it up and inviting in the union, you know. Yeah. Union, yoga, to yoke, you know. There's one method, meditation, connection. There's others, you know. This just happens to be mine. It just happens to come in a very human way, where we're speaking. That is like being to being. But we're connected. You know, it's like our spirits are kind of talking to each other, like, hey, this is where you need to grow. Hey, this is what I'm working on. And together, when we find that union, it's like coming together with the perfect partner. It's like the water's part, you know. For a moment, you just feel like you've, like, come home, or you feel like you're seen, or you feel like, you know, wow. And you know, you don't feel like, wow, I'm loved right now, just for being me. Yeah, so very long, extensive answer, but it's what's in my heart.
Yeah, that's great. So, you personally, I think you're very good about saying that you are yourself a student, mm-hmm. and on a path, on your path.
Yeah.
What do you do personally, if I might ask, that is your, you know, keeps your flame going, as you say.
Mm.
Was your practice?
Wow. That's a good question. There's a lot. There's a lot. I think of it like a soup. And it's not always the same. I like variety. But I know that whatever I do, I need to keep flow happening. So whether it's in moments of anger or sadness or pure joy, just I let the energy move. For me, that comes in through, I love to dance. Doesn't always look pretty, but it's moving. I love to use my voice as sound and let it out. Doesn't always sound pretty, but it's moving. You know, it doesn't need to sound beautiful. It's energy. And energy is all kinds of ways. I write.
You write.
Yeah. Nature is, it's so important, you know, just to be out and listen. Think about everyone stuck in office buildings and they're just going, like, they've been inside all day. What's the first thing we do? It's just like, maybe that and maybe, why? Because we've come out of wherever we are and we're opening up and we're breathing, you know? It's much bigger. It's rich. Connection with others can be in anything. You know, it can be friendships, family, romance, and all of us humans have a lot of lessons to learn in that. But in those moments where it's just flowing, it feels great, you know? So, those are some ways. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I do what makes my heart the happiest. And the reason I say I'm a student first is because what makes my heart the happiest is teaching. And when I teach, the flow comes right through. Because I think we all have a throne. I've never seen it this way, but I'm sitting on the throne of what I'm here to do. It's like I feel like I've taken my place and something, this feeling of rightness that I've searched for, it just feels right at that moment, you know? I'm happy to sit and learn from someone, but when I sit and share, it's it, you know? So I like to do stuff that other people like to do. Like, I like to paint, but I'm not, like, this amazing painter, you know? I love art. I love music. Mm-hmm. But it's, for me, what keeps me on my game the most is sharing what's inside. And what's inside comes out through speaking and writing the most. So, yeah.
And play.
I play with kids. I play with animals. I ridiculously laugh at inappropriate times, and that's who I am. Hmm. So I make no apologies anymore. You know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, play. That should be the number one answer. Hmm. That's how I do it. Yeah.
So you're not, I mean, I don't feel from you at all that you have any pretenses. Like, it's very, you know, you're not someone who would fit in the, you would fit, but it would be not cookie cutter, in some kind of new age spiritual box.
I actually think part of not feeling like I fit was the part of my struggle before, because I didn't know where I fit. I couldn't put it into a box, you know? I come from small town Midwest, you know, and, like, it didn't seem to fit. Even when I was in school, I didn't fit into a category of things or people, you know? I wasn't super sports. I wasn't super music. I wasn't super art, and, you know? I wasn't super, like, hide in my room and read books, you know, and, like, very intelligent that way, you know, or computer. I just had a little bit of everything. And that's how that this world of more holistic studies and what maybe New Age was introduced to me. It was piece by piece. I liked yoga. I even went through yoga teacher training, but I didn't, like, oh, I'm a yoga teacher, you know. I liked massage. I liked the body. I went through it. I stayed a therapist for a while, but that was just a tool. Same with coaching. And then come to a place like the Omega Institute, and suddenly you're exposed to everything you haven't seen before. Some people love past life regression stuff. Some people love quantum physics, you know. Some people love working with shamans, you know. Some people are like, I'm all about the angels, you know, or I'm really into like sustainability and like permaculture, you know. And I've somehow stood in the middle of it all, which makes some things undefinable, but I'm okay with it for the first time, you know, which feels like okay, you know. I mean, I still go home and wrench cars, you know, back in the Midwest. This is what I was born doing, you know. I started off as a mechanic and as a server in restaurants, and like this is, but I've never, those are still pieces of me. I haven't shed any of it. It's who I am, you know. I love playing with babies, but I love hanging out with old people and just holding their hand and listening to their wisdom. It's just, it's across the board, you know. Mm-hmm. It doesn't, so, yeah. Nothing hurts more when you're trying to figure yourself out than someone going, well, what do you do? You're like, I don't, you know. Well, it's like they're trying to go, where do you belong? And you don't know. And that's where my heart and soul comes in, like this like guide and like this mama bear for all of these visionaries that are going, I don't know where I fit. Well, you don't fit because you're part of our world that's changing and you're part of leading it. So you're not supposed to fit. But they still don't have that confidence, and I didn't have any. And they're like, what do you do? I hate that question. You know? It's like, we're so used to it with each other. You go to any networking events, any business stuff, well, what do you do? What do you do? And it's like, you know? It feels great when you have a title. Like, I would love to say, I am an accountant, you know? Like, but I'm not an accountant, you know? Or, you know? It felt great to say, like, well, I am program director for a building, because I was. Or, you know, like, or I'm a massage therapist, or I'm a mechanic. Like, those are titles. But think about all the people, if you're out there and changing, you know, you have stuff pumping through you that it just doesn't fit. That's when I jump in. And I'm like, Mama Bear, like, no, we got this, and you are perfect right now. Like, let's just keep nurturing, you know, what wants to come out of you. And, yeah. That's where I will stand as like one of the members of like the 300 tribe, the movie, and be like, nobody's gonna touch my babies, you know. So that is where the fierce comes out. No, you know.
So would you say you see yourself as part of a growing, say, network of people who are bringing light into the world?
I would say yes, absolutely, but the light has to come from within first. So I have a hard time standing next to people telling other people what to do when they haven't done their own inner work. It's an ongoing process. So bringing light into the world, yes. Being the light, yes. That's it. Being the light and being the love. And kind of taking down some of this is not taking down. I don't like to war against anything, you know. Some people are, and that's really important now because there's a lot of systems in place that they're off. There's a major imbalance that's happened. So all of us are bringing balance in our own way back to the world. And my way is through working with everyone, you know, to heal and grow from within so they can change the world. And they know that it's that we're writing history by the moment, you know. So. It's beautiful out here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you are yourself, and you're helping other people to be themselves. Is that essentially what we're doing here?
Yes. I think it is. No, I mean, I don't think if you ever asked me if I wasn't my, if you ask anyone if they're not being themselves, people are. But as we kind of learn that we actually can shed some of what's inside of us, or, you know, kind of, that we're not victim to circumstance all the time, you know, then we become a new version of ourselves. There's this crystal that I used to carry around with me, and it's called a phantom quartz. And it looks like it's like grown inside of it, grown like new layers of itself, you know. It's like the perpetual shedding of the phoenix energy, rise, burn, rise, rebirth, you know. Burn. And I think that life's a cycle, just like nature. So, I facilitate others' freedom, however they're wanting to grow. That's what I do the best. And it just happens to involve play. And it happens to involve, like, supercharging and discovering and supercharging and unleashing that passion.
So, can you tell me about some of the people you've worked with and, like, maybe the examples? No names.
No names? Like, of that have been clients? Or?
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Sure. Okay. That's good. I got a good one. 2010, I had a really scary decision to make. For me, it was scary. I had held a position working with a lot of famous people. I'd be flown out to events, and I felt like that was, you know, I'd be. And I had just decided to give up my massage license. I was living in Arizona, and I got this phone call. And this woman said, I'm hosting a retreat in Mexico. It's like an R&R retreat, and I need a massage therapist. And I was like, are you kidding me? And the reason I mentioned my job is because the retreat fell on the same day as the next conference we were going to be working. And I knew that if I didn't go to the conference, there was a lot of departmental changes and big changes, that I probably wouldn't be invited back to hold this job. It was everything was just shifting on that end, you know. I was the only one that they were flying out to work these events. So I knew that they wanted to, you know, save money within the system and all that. So, gone. You know, that was happening. And I thought, maybe, I don't know why, but what if I did go to Mexico to do this? So I did. I gave up this job and this comfort that I knew I had that was, you know, to me very prestigious in certain ways. And I drove my car to Mexico. This is the wildest adventure. And I landed at this R&R, this villa that this woman rented out. And I had asked her, I said, well, I love massage therapy. I'm more than happy to assist, but can I bring my other tools? So she said yes. Well, one by one, all these women started to show up. And I had no idea who was going to be at this event. And they were between the ages of my mother and grandmother. So I thought, wow, like these are women that I like bowed down to for their wisdom. And here's me facilitating something. And I just thought, I had this moment of self-doubt. I said, no, I'm just going to serve any way that I can. And one woman kind of circled around me for almost 2 weeks. And she finally came in and she says, I'd like to, you know, do some body work with you. I said, perfect. Come on in. And I had gotten in the habit of just talking to them for a few minutes, understanding like what was moving through or where they were at. And when she came into my room, I had music playing. And she says, oh, music. She was beautiful. She was like this tall woman, and she would sparkle, but I could see sadness behind her eyes. I never understood why. She goes, music. She goes, I used to play with my son. He died 26 years ago, and I stopped playing. And I was like, you know, as any kind of therapist, you're like, ding, ding, ding. You know, like, wow, there's pain trapped in her body, you know. And so I had put out a prayer at that time because I knew massage therapy wasn't my thing. I loved coaching, but I was like, what is it? You know, I love music. How does that weave in? How does dance move into what I do? And so I'm sitting there across from this woman who's very well maintained, you know, very songbird and soft. And she's telling me this story, and I hear like classical kind of like music start to play in the background, very melodious, like just, you know, movement centered. And I said, well, before we sit down, will you move with me a little bit? I closed the door. It was a nice big room. And I grabbed some scarves off a wall, you know, and I said, let's just move. So we started to move, and she was like, oh, this is sweet. And then all of a sudden, I hear tribal drums. And I was having this communication, and I said, no way. I'm not going to play tribal drums for this woman. But I was honoring really what was coming through at that point. I thought, why not? So I put on tribal drums, and I said, okay, we're just going to, I wish I was standing because I would love to show you this. I said, we're going to just stand in, like, you know, let's just hit the ground, you know, with our feet, you know, and just, and she's like, okay. She's like, you know, and I'm like, well, let's just make like maybe like a growl sound because I felt this energy. I was just like, okay. And she's looking at me, and she's mimicking me. And so she started looking, she goes, and all of a sudden this anger and pain started to come out of her. From all of my years of trauma, I'm not afraid of any emotion, and I know how to hold it now, you know. I would never open something up I didn't know how to hold, but I had never seen this before. So I just said, okay, let's just keep going. And she's unraveling. And then this dream was just coming through, and it was like, you know, I didn't even remember, but it was alluding to, like, don't hold this in. No one would have wanted this for yourself. Your son wouldn't have wanted this. Like, it's this free, you know, just, and she's, and she emptied. And I looked at her, and I didn't really know what to do. And I said, okay, now get on my table, you know. And I put my hands under her head, and I have never felt, like, source move right through me. And it filled her. And I was just in tears, and she's just like, you know, and I just held her. And it was that moment that I said, you know what, I would do this for the rest of my life. I don't know what exactly just happened, but I understand that someone let go of something very big, and that someone is filling up with something really needed, that nourishment of their heart and soul. And I just held her. And if that wasn't enough, the very next day, I go around the corner and I hear music. And this woman, who hadn't picked up a guitar or any instrument for 26 years, was sitting there, and she was playing, and she was singing, and she was free. And I was like, okay, all right, game on. You know, and it's continued. The work has just deepened so much. And anytime I see someone, like, just go from this to this, I'm like, okay, you know. Or start to just let go of all these little ties and move toward their dreams, I'm like, okay. That moment you see self-worth kind of kick in and flip in someone's eyes where they get it. Like, oh. You know, I've got tears, you know, it's like, no one can take that away, you know. I don't care if this work is definable or not at this moment. We're changing lives. I'm changing lives. I'm assisting in changing the life of someone. And it's coming from a pure heart. So, there you go.
Wow, that's beautiful.
Wow.
So, apologize for getting formal when the camera turns on, you know?
Yeah.
But, my question now for you is, oh, airplane going by. You know, okay, what is next for you, Crystal?
Mm. What's next? Yeah. Well, I can aim toward what I think is next. I have a couple things. After many, many years of prayer and moving toward and not, you know, and just, what's it, foraging through, the work is expanding, so that's super exciting. I just got featured in an old art and culture magazine called Funky Fresh. That was very cool. It's all for creatives and visionaries and all done by creatives. That was fantastic. The college that I went to in Arizona just asked me to do a video for all their graduates, so that's done. I'm one of the authors in a collective book coming out in a few months. And so what's next is I have another book in the works. I'm excited just to put some of this on paper. But really the bigger picture, I'm just ready to play bigger, you know? Like, I feel like there's so many of us that with that energy of yesterday in class, like, there's this movement. There's something moving through of just, like, gathering more of that, of people, so we can move forward together, you know? There's this wild... I think being both in front and behind the scenes on leading something much bigger than myself, whether it's a movement, you know, just allowing our essence to shine and like teaching others how to shed whatever's coming up, you know, and reminding them of what's true or bringing forth their truth out. That's a better way to put it, you know, providing the community for support. Of support and of a place that they can come and share and gather. You know, there's places like this all over the world, but in particularly with a lot of visionaries and young people that just need that extra support system where they may not get it from their families, you know, or some of their friends may get it, but they feel so much and they don't know what to do with what's going on inside of them and like how to focus their passions. I mean, this is our growth, yes, but there's a lot we can do when we bridge together. So, for me, that's that. What else? Teaching classes. My intention is to teach them all over. So, bridging with places that are already doing it and having it be these win-win situations. You know, I love that. Online. Online, even more so, some of this movement, but reaching people that way. There's so many people out there so I'm building more of my online community and sites and offerings and classes and videos. So there's a lot in the works. It's actually very exciting. A lot of it's already moving, which is fun. And I'm working with some groups in Florida. Gonna start traveling a little bit more again. So I already have 4 other invitations: Chicago, Arizona. New York next year, so I'll be moving around, North Carolina, so that's it. I come where I'm called. But I'd like to start collaborating more with others that are doing this, you know, and it's not just ground up. I think that's been the delay over the years, is trying to think of, you know, doing it all. No, it's like, no, just get out there. There's a lot of people, and we bridge together and, you know, make stuff happen. So, yeah. But the vision's always evolving. So, very, very clearly to answer your question, next, what's next, is more teaching and traveling. around. Building a bigger online community and really bridging people together that way. And almost starting something that feels like it's a movement about to birth, you know, where we come together and join forces and really enjoy being alive and learn how to enjoy being alive, you know, and how we can put our gifts out to the world that we're not sure how to do yet. So it's bigger than I can see, but I can feel it. Yeah. There you go.
Everything went all bright when you were talking just now. Probably just because I was staring one place.
I think the sun came out.
Yeah. It's like, it was cool though. I was like, oh, just go with it. So what do you think about enlightenment? We got Adi Shanti come here tomorrow.
Yes.
Adi Shanti, yeah. Profound spiritual teacher.
Yes.
What is your take on all of that enlightenment, you know? Because me, I come from, I've done a lot of training with a person who claims to be enlightened.
Got it.
And he's very direct about it.
Right.
He got enlightened actually on a specific time, a specific day. So London, year 2000, June 19th at 5 a.m. That's when he got enlightened.
Okay.
And, but then when you ask him about it, it's like, well, it's not exactly what you think it is at all. And so, I've always been fascinated by enlightenment. That's my way in to Omega, for example. I'm just curious about what your take on that word, that whole thing is.
Hmm. Enlightenment. I used to get pissed off about this word. that's the truth. Because everything felt incredibly difficult to me. So I look at spiritual teachers all around the world. I'm fascinated by their stories. And just let everyone hold whatever they're claiming or being, you know, and I bow in reverence to many of them. The subject enlightenment for myself, to me, enlighten. All I've known, all I've understood in a lot of ways are ways that we can lighten from within. Lighten, again, to let that essence out, to let that radiance out, to let that, our being be what feels like free, right? So I have a bridge right in the middle, you know, I do. I approach it from a very going, okay, this is what the human may be struggling with. Here's a bigger version or a bigger vision, you know, of what could be going on. And like, let's work with whatever's coming up that feels like it's trapping in. And so enlightened to me is an ongoing process. I think that we hit these moments, yes, big peak moments. Sometimes it's like through the chaos, like boom, we open up and suddenly we've shed something really big. We're able to do it, you know. Sometimes we come across teachers where their light is just so powerful. They're the energy coming off of them, it's like it transforms us, you know. It helps us remember who we are. It's like you almost feel like we can shed like a layer of skin, you know, or a shell. And so I do my best to just see people through the eyes of love,